Okay, so I'll start with the introduction. We have with us Dr. Sanjay Bell. He doesn't need any introduction because he was today's keynote speaker. He's the Director General for CERTN. I would request him to join the stage, sir. The next panelist is Mr. Brijesh Singh, IPS. He again doesn't need any special introduction because he's an eminent personality from a law enforcement perspective, especially evangelizing IT among the law enforcement circle. So I would like to welcome Mr. Brijesh Singh, IPS. He's the IGP Cyber for Maharashtra Police. So he's currently based out of Mumbai and taking care of the cyber activities for Maharashtra Police. Also, the third panelist is Mr. Vladimir Ketlov. He is the CEO for Elcomsoft. Welcome, Mr. Vladimir. Okay, so before we start, let me set the context or have some words on the current cyber forensic perspective. So all of you know that the number of cases being reported is increasing. At the same time, the number of incidents are also increasing. On top of it, we have a lot of compliance requirements. If you are into the banking industry or the critical infrastructure, we have a lot of compliance requirements also to be met, which addresses certain forensic requirements. But the new technologies like the blockchain or the IoT, these are, you know, giving us new challenges, or we are facing a lot of problems. This is what is going to be the core agenda for today's discussion. At the same time, we have the PPP model also coming in, where we have new labs being set up adopting the PPP model. So this is also one of the core agenda for today's discussion. And then the capacity building is another area. So I would like to start with Mr. Vladimir, who's going to talk about the latest technologies from a forensic perspective. And from there, we'll pick it up.
Okay, sure. I will very quickly introduce myself. I'm Sian, the one of Elcomsoft, the company based in Moscow, Russia. And for over 20 years, we're developing the software to help police and law enforcement to investigate the crime. Not only computer crime, but everything that have the computers and technologies involved. Now we concentrate mainly on the mobile and cloud forensics. Why it is important? Nowadays, mobile devices, not only smartphones, but quite a lot of things, keep tons of confidential and private and personal and otherwise extremely important information, even more than on your desktop computers. You have everything, actually, all your life is in there, and businesses, taking in mind the bring your own device approach, there's also a lot of confidential data there, your personal, your bank accounts, your mail conversations, your calls, credit cards, and much more. and so on. The challenges that the law enforcement frequently encounter is how to extract and how to decrypt all that data. I haven't checked the statistics recently, but about a year ago, there were at least about 50,000 different Android smartphone models. They're based on a limited number of chipsets and hardware, but still, for every new model, probably the new approach have to be used if the smartphone is locked. Even if it's not locked, it's extremely hard to get everything from there. You cannot just remove the memory chip and read all the data nowadays, because the encryption is being used. With the Apple iPhones, it is even harder because their protection is stronger. So the new challenge that has started, I would say, about 5 years ago, like getting information directly from the cloud. I'm sure you are familiar with Apple iCloud, with Google, of course, and with Microsoft accounts. And from month to month, they store more and more data from your devices, and you don't always have control how the data is synced between your device and the cloud. And you probably don't know how much information is collected by all those vendors. And there is actually even more. For example, in the United States, one of the most popular clouds is Amazon. Speaking of Alexa devices, that's a little bit different things. We can back to it later. It's about IoT, Internet of Things. But Alexa is always listening what you are saying. And if you check the Amazon account, it's not really easy to get in there. You will see that all the everything you said, that the starting with Alexa word, is there. And if the text was recognized, it is in there. If not, there is a record in MP3 format. And the most popular cloud in the world by the number of users is actually WeChat one, very popular in China. There is more and more in that. There is another cloud by Samsung cloud, which keeps contacts, messages, pictures. Everything you shoot on your Samsung phone goes directly to Samsung cloud and until you manually disable that. The other company from China, Xiaomi, has also its own cloud, Mi Cloud, and also a lot of data goes there. And there is much more. Even drones like DJI have their own cloud now, and the data you don't control go there. And of course, it is quite important for police and law enforcement to collect all the data they can. 10 years ago, these were only computers, PCs, and Macs. And they were not really protected. Now they're protected stronger, but even more important, as I said, that much more information is now stored on the smartphones and in the clouds. And it's not really easy to get there. But the profit of looking in the cloud is that quite often you get much more data from there, even deleted one. Deleted data and even the data created many years ago. When we first make the software to pull the data from the Google, I was really surprised to find the location data from my trips to the US that happened 15 years ago. I never used Google at that time. I used actually iPhone, not 15, sorry, about 10 years. But still quite a lot, and a lot of personal and critical data. And that employs not only the risk for your private and personal data, there are also a lot of risks for the business and well. And there is also a blackmailing, and you probably remember the case about 3 years ago, Celebgate, when the Apple iCloud accounts of over 100 celebrities has been leaked. Someone used phishing to get the credentials and pull their private data from there. So now we are working actually with some of those clouds helping to extract the data, but there are many challenges. That the first one is legal questions. Not in all the countries it is possible, even with the court order, to access the cloud data. It is easy in some, in the United States, for example, in Russia as well. I don't know about India, sorry. But it is almost prohibited in Germany. It is really hard in the UK. In the UK, there is only one single agency that can legally access their cloud data. It is GCHQ. It's a part of MI5 or MI6, something like that. And the second challenge is, of course, is technical. The vendors, there are many vendors. Second, they frequently update their network protocols, the encryption algorithms, the formats of data that used to store this data. There is also another way the law enforcement agency can send a direct request to Apple or Microsoft, and there is a publicly available statistics on their website, how many requests they received and how many data is provided. But that's a very long way. Sometimes it takes months or even a year, and the way that the data may expire. And from what we have heard from law enforcement, if they weren't able to break into some data in 48 hours, then the chances to disclose to solve the crime falls in two times. So we also need to be fast and to react on all those changes by the vendors and also the legal changes as well. And the next step probably will be the Internet of Things discovery. Some of the devices sending with your without your knowledge the data to their own clouds, and some of the data is stored right in some memory chip inside a device. That includes smartwatches, that includes smart speakers, that may even include some devices built into your freezer or whatever. Everything is now connected to the internet, connected to the local network, and have a computer inside. And in some cases, police have to investigate dozens of different devices in just one single crime. So it becomes harder and harder.
Thank you so much, Vladimir. So basically, Vladimir pointed out a couple of very interesting points. First is basically how much of our data is there on the internet. And secondly, how much easily it is available for the law enforcement, even if we have the court order. So with that context, let's go to Mr. Brijesh Singh. I would like to put across a few points to him. The first one is, what is the forensic state as of now in India? Maybe if you can highlight what happened in the last 5 years and today, where do we stand? And from there, I would also request you if you can highlight the number of financial crimes that is happening, especially from the citizen perspective. A lot of people are being victim of these kind of crimes. What the police is doing, or are you facing any challenges in that? And also the capacity building from a forensic perspective.
That's a lot. To begin with, let's start with the registration of crimes. So we are in a strange situation where almost every crime has a digital component. It has some communication, some geolocation, some message, some financial deal. So that way, every crime can be said to be under the IT Act and under cybercrime. While on the other part, serious crimes are never reported. So most people would have heard of the Bangladesh bank heist, but something double of that, $171 million happened in India. It was never investigated. Now Bail Sahib is here, he must be getting reports of hundreds of incidents per day, but they never culminate into investigation. Now, when you do investigation from a corporate point of view, you are just interested in certain reports. But in a law enforcement investigation, the trouble starts after that. The technical part of getting evidence is probably you'll break encryption if you can, at least, or extract data in a way that you can sustain it in court of law. But your real problem of investigation starts after that, right from maintaining evidence integrity to data carving to whatever. This is a legally cumbersome process, and this is now being complicated by cloud. You don't even know where which part of data is stored where, with what encryption, which country is there, which country has which laws, and how much time will it take to respond. You know, I have a point to make here. When it comes to protection of intellectual property, they are very keen and they act immediately. But when it is my national security, they are not bothered. It is amazing. Probably we seem to be a weak country. That is why we take all this bullshit from all these companies. We should kick in their aspects of anatomy and tell them to give data when it is required for national security purposes. Because, you know, there are countries which have very, very well-developed offensive cyber capabilities. We are a democracy. We do not have a mandate. I mean, right before this, there were people from various agencies, and we were talking amongst ourselves. Nobody has a mandate for offensive cyber, right? But you go to Pakistan, they have excellent, excellent facilities for offensive cyber operations. Go to China. Their unit 61398 is one of the APT units, and they have amazing capabilities for integrated warfare. Now, even if you want to do forensics on an APT, what kind of data retention policies are there, what kind of encryption is being used, where is it, how would you do you know, attribution, where is the CNC hosted? Even if the CNC is not hosted in China, if it is hosted in some Eastern European country who is not ready to give you data, that fragment of data is there, plus so on and so forth. You would never be, forensics will come when you will get hold of data. You're not going to get hold of data. In one case of terrorism, Yahoo till the end did not give us data. Yahoo did not give us, you know, data from terrorist emails citing some privacy or whatever. Now, when it comes to protection of intellectual property, or when it comes to some business laws, then you are very smart, right? Then, you know, you come up with laws and then you start teaching us that, oh, IP compliance is not proper in India, and, you know, that we need to do something about this. But when it comes to people, you know, attacking my infrastructure, radicalizing people, or, you know, using, you know, any kind of messengers for organizing terrorist activities, then you don't get data. So this also has to be sorted out. This you know, aspect of, secondly, to get data, that data would have to be stored, right? Now, there is no clarity on storage of data. There are rules about what data should be stored till what time. But if it is not in India, once GDPR comes, then life would be more difficult for everybody, because the whole of Europe is going to ask everybody to follow GDPR. And it would be virtually impossible to get any kind of personally identifiable information from anywhere, even for an investigation purpose. We see that you send a request to whosoever of these big companies, and they never respond. They say that it's in a queue, and your country sends a lot of requests, because my country has, you know, 1 in 6 people from all over the world is from my country, right? So we are going to send more requests. Then they come up with reports saying that, oh, in India, you know, Facebook and all, they come up with reports saying that, you know, there are too many requests from India, so there's no freedom of expression in India, and so on and so forth. Please come and handle this country then. You know, it's such a large and complex country that our you know, I worked in Bombay Police, and somebody from some European country had come, and he was giving me gyan on you know, crime rates and this and that. So I said, what's the population of your country? It must be some, kitna, I mean, some 1 lakh, 2 lakh, 3 lakh, 5 lakh people. So my office was just opposite VT railway station. I said, look there. He looked there. I said, you know, 6 million people cross this every day. This is my jurisdiction. So now this is the situation. If we are making these requests, we are not doing this because, you know, we find some great fun in getting this data. We need this data for investigation. And it takes away your credibility, because something has happened and you can't get data from these service providers. They want to do business in my country, but they don't want to give data to me. But when it comes to some bloody film or something, then they are going to block everything immediately. No, you just try this out. Whenever their interests are involved, you'll get all data, all compliances, all blocking immediately. John Doe notices and cease and desist and DMCA and whatnot. Every mechanism is there. But for cases of terrorism, no data is available. Then all kinds of, you know, freedom of expression and everything would come into play. And, you know, if you, there's a nice talk by a chap called, he's dead now, Yuri Brezhmonov. Just check how influence operations are used, right? Now, there are countries, if you look at a lot of countries which are affecting, you know, public opinion here, where do I get forensic data for this? Let us say I give a range of, you know, 200 IPs, or I give 1,000, let us say, Twitter bots to Twitter, it will take me 3 years to respond to. You just check for an indictment of Internet Research Organization from Vladimir's country. There's a company called Internet Research Organization by a chap called Prigozhin. They have been indicted by a US court for influencing the US elections. Now, in this case, where do I get the forensic data from? And I know for sure that this is happening in my country also. But how do I stop it? Where do I get the data from? But having said this, all is not so bleak. At least in Maharashtra, we have been able to open one cyber crime lab and one cyber police station in each district of Maharashtra. So Maharashtra has 44 policing districts. We have one cyber lab in each, you know, and it has the works. You name it, it has everything. So it has, I recently purchased 84 UFEDs, right? The Cellebrite UFED, which was mentioned in that San Bernardino case, Apple versus FBI. So that device costs 25 to 30 lakhs. I have purchased 84 of them, and I'm about to deploy them. I've got FREDs, I've got SoloForce, whatever you mentioned, I've got. Now the question would come, oh, can your policemen, can your mamus operate this? No, my dear, come to my office and have a half an hour conversation with my constable. He'll teach you a thing or two. You know, I'm giving this an open invitation. Please come to us. You know, Durga Dubey is there from Reliance, and he knows our unit, and you can come to our unit and talk to them, and they would tell you a thing or two. Because they have seen so many products in last 1 or 2 years, right from Israelis to Australians, everybody is coming and demonstrating us products. So if you look at 10 products, then you understand what is going on there, right? So we can now even write specs for whatever you want. even do consultancy. So Maharashtra has been on the forefront. It has, we have been able to come up with this district labs. We have given basic training. And the constables were so interested that a 5-day training course for 5 hours, they would not leave the lecturer till 8 or 9 in the night, and they would also consume Saturday and Sunday. So they're, you know, itna bhook hai janne ka. So they wanted to know so much. And it's new when people pick up. And I think that our response is going to improve. Earlier, people did not come to us because they thought that, oh, ye gali ka doctor hai, iske paas mein, you know, he won't be able to treat this cancer or brain surgery. But we are developing skills. We are getting infrastructure. Yes, it is catch up always. We are going to be behind the curve, but we also get excellent support from the community. I mean, in cases of terrorism, probably there may be people available here in this room who have come and helped us. And I'm extremely thankful to the community for all the help which I get from them. And I believe that this cooperation continues.
Thank you so much, Mr. Brijesh. So, one of the very interesting point was how technically capable the Maharashtra police is. But one of the problem or the gap area that we might be seeing is, okay, Maharashtra is excellent, it's doing good. How about some state from where a lot of, you know, these fake calls happening, the bank scams happening, they might not have these kind of infrastructure or trained manpower. So this is where maybe from the central government or from one of the central agencies where we have to balance the gap. So with that point, let me go to Dr. Sanjay. Sir, if you could touch upon any of the forensic initiatives from the CERT perspective, as well as forensic standards, if any, or standardization across the country, as well as your comments on the PPP model for forensic labs, as well as... Yes, I didn't want to name the state.
You've done an excellent work there.
Yes, sir. So, if you can start with that.
No, I think these wishing calls and all these have been going around for quite some time. We did have a lot of interactions with the parliamentarians, and one of the tasks was to go ahead and do something specific in this case where all these calls have been going out. So, we did sit with the various technology providers within the government, as well as with various agencies who are involved on ground, and drew up some sort of an action plan. And obviously, the action plan was executed by the Ministry of Home Affairs, where all this falls in. Basic approach followed was, yes, action has to be taken, because people were sitting, I'm sure you all have seen, on rooftops, on tree branches, etc., and doing all these calls. It was a crazy situation. And there was a spurt of new massive bungalows built all across different streets and all, where actually you didn't have money to survive. And here you're seeing a huge lot of construction activities happening. And then obviously when a good lady police officer took charge, was determined to take action, went ahead with all the necessary, if I can call it, dramatics and works to make sure that they're after these goons, they were put behind bars. And now you've seen a sudden drop in all this. and the same sort of thing is now being replicated anywhere else that is being done. So having said that, going to standards, yes, there's a huge gap in standards. I don't think standards are existing today. It needs to be worked upon. But there's some work happening in the area of getting some of these labs certified so that whatever forensics work is happening in that, that should be able to be presented in a court of law. I think that's a great model which Brijesh has adopted in Maharashtra. If that can be replicated across all the other states, it'll be very, very good. The challenge that I see on the ground is even when people have an issue, they try and go and report to a cybercrime cell in a state, the FIRs are not lodged. And that's the basic problem. If the FIR is not lodged, there is going to be no investigation. So at the end of the day, there is some metrics that is required, how many FIRs lodged, how many closed, etc., which is used for monitoring each police station. When your FIR is not there, nothing to be closed, right? So the police station is always got 3 stars. So that's one of the challenges which exists. I think not everyone has been so successful to ensure that the workforce is trained and has that necessary capacity to understand or get 10 vendors come, explain what's happening and get educated. So that's the challenge across the country. So in terms of capacity building that you asked, while in the morning I did mention there are some 51 colleges where some of these courses are being done, but apart from that, NILIT itself is running a very detailed, technical, long-term course in cyber forensics. It used to be done earlier by Gorakhpur, and they run only 3 courses. One was on governance, the second one on network, and the third on forensics. To get into these courses, it was a fairly stringent test. I am not aware of the latest in the last couple of months. And very few could actually clear it to even go and qualify for doing that course. And that course was, I think, if I'm not wrong, about a 5-month course or something. So those are small initiatives. I'm not saying that will give you that scale which is required. But yes, as Vladimir also mentioned, the complexity is becoming so much. You have to go into the details and depths. If you are not able to go into the details and depth, I don't know how you're going to be solving issues where cloud is involved, where IoT is involved, okay, where all these new technologies are involved. And the moment you have quantum coming in, you're going to have a tremendous challenge. How are you going to handle that? Because now you won't even see anything. He talked about GDPR, etc. Who's going to give you the data from a privacy perspective? So I think as a society, we all need to sit down and figure out what is the sort of balance we need. When should it be available and to whom it should be available and how should it be available? So if you say by putting backdoors or giving keys, that is not a solution. What is the solution and how will you do it? Because that's going to be the challenge for the technology companies when they're developing these technologies. So it's, while society definitely does not require all this, the law enforcement requires, because the society will go back to law enforcement saying, this is what has happened, help us. And they say, this is what you wanted. You did not want any keys to be available, nothing to be available. How do I help you? Then what are you going to do? So I think everyone needs to sit down and debate and understand and figure out what needs to be done.
Thank you so much, sir. Just 2 more quick questions. First question, do you think there is a shortage of technically qualified forensic resources
there is,
in India?
There is a huge shortage.
Huge shortage.
Huge. Okay. Probably huge is an understatement.
Okay. And second is, like, what are our plans to address the forensic requirement for the future technologies like IoT or blockchain? Where do we stand?
That is where I was looking towards Vladimir to figure out where, you know, when he talked about PPP and all that. So I am trying to see how, where these technologies have already been deployed, how can we get that sort of system? Because he talked about issues and challenges from MLAT, and he also touched upon those issues and getting all these things is a huge challenge. If data is residing somewhere else, that is why you're seeing these restrictive policies coming in, where everyone's saying, okay, if you have your servers residing in the country, at least the law of the land is applicable. So I think there are some possibilities of learning as to how it has been done in some of the other countries, and probably how that sort of a capacity building exercise can be carried out within India, because it is not going to be a scenario where this does not impact India or does not impact so-and-so country, it's only impacting India. You take the case of Blue Whale itself. Is that an issue of crime? I really don't know. I'll leave it for everyone to figure out. And there were cases where I think Russia did some amazing work. Could that have been accordingly looked at with some of the other countries which were impacted or not? How could it have been done? What sort of capacity could have been built? Could we have avoided some of the situations which was there? So I think I'll leave it to Vladimir to talk about.
Thank you so much. So we'll open the floor for questions. If you have, we have like 7 minutes. So if you have any questions to any of the panelists, we'll take 3 questions, and then if time permits, we'll.
Check. Sir, these companies in India, for example, ISPs or service providers, they are bounded by the law. Like if there is any LA issue, they are supposed to answer. But what about the content providers like WhatsApp and all coming from other countries? How does the law binds on them? Are they, who is looking at them? Who is regulating them?
The question was directed towards the policeman. Yeah, so next time you have to specify whom are you targeting the question. No, if you are operating here, you are regulated by the law here. Okay, so there is a clear requirement of obeying what is the law and also complying to it. If so, you can't open an office here until you sign various documents, right? So there are all those things are in place. So when it comes to not complying to certain things, as you said, there are delays, etc. So there are different other mechanisms with government to government, etc., to take those up and sort those out. All that is there, but the speed at which it is required, probably that is what is a huge challenge at this point in time.
Hi. Just wanted to understand one thing. I think the community in India is extremely vibrant, right? I wanted to understand from the two of you and from you, how can the community's energies be channelized to help the government's cause better? I think we are still far from doing that properly. Maybe a country like Russia can hold lessons for us in terms of channelizing the community itself.
Listen, you know, let me say this. China has patriotic hacker networks, right? The Honkes are like 2 million strong. How many of you are ready to work without money for national this thing purposes? Don't make me say that, right? If we are just looking for bug bounty, where is national interest in that? Don't even come to that.
I think he answered everything, right? No, I think this is the same point which I raised in the morning in my talk. And I think people have to start understanding, are you interested in safeguarding the motherland, or we just want to leave it to the Army, Navy and Air Force to do that? And while we want to say, no, until I'm making some money, I'm not going to do it. Because if you don't have your motherland, what are you trying to do? Right? On one side, we say this is a bloodless war, so you are all warriors in that bloodless war. So I think the point which he's raising is extremely valid, and people need to start seriously thinking about it.
I'll add to that. Okay, there are 10,000 things wrong about this country. Okay? There are vulnerabilities in this system, that system, UIDI, everywhere there are vulnerabilities. Right? Okay. Now, come ahead and help us solve, help us patch them, rather than going out there and tom-tomming and saying that, oh, I have broken this window. I am great. Just because I had a stone and I could break this window. That's nothing great. You know, it's not great to break a window. Please come, and if there is a critical national infrastructure, you know something about it, come and talk to us. Right? Come to CERT. Just one single email. Come to CERT. And they are very serious. I have seen this. They are very serious. Certain things which we sent up to them, they are very serious. Dr. Behl would, you know, sometimes at night also respond, and he would ensure that he'll move mountains. So a lot of work happens. And see, he's moved from private sector to government. So you can't even accuse us of being of government mentality or whatever, you know.
No. Let him also go. You said the question is directed to all three.
About just to make sure that I understand the question correctly, how community can help law enforcement? That's a hard question, actually, because tell a quick story that when we just started over 20 years ago, that was really hard to us as a vendor, as a step to talk and to communicate with the government and law enforcement, and there is almost no way to the community, like private persons, whether it is ethical hackers or researchers or whoever, to talk directly to the government, and it will probably create even more trouble to law enforcement than a profit. There are some cases when government agencies directly buy, say, zero date exploits for some important things. But that's not the right thing to go. That better for the community to work with the vendors and for the vendors to talk, to the law enforcement. Even now, probably every second law enforcement agency have to use at least couple of dozen different software packages from different vendors, and it is really hard. They have to learn people how to use them, and they there is no single standard for forensic data, how they have to be presented to the court. For example, everything is different. Here you have PDF file, here you have only a printed copy, here some data is missing, here there is no verification by hashes that the data hasn't been modified, and it's already quite a lot of work. But at the same time, there is no single company that can provide all the forensic software together in a single package that does everything, including making coffee. So the best way is to start with requirements from the government and from law enforcement. What they actually need, what they're missing at the moment. The second step should be to define more clear standards and to have face-to-face meeting with the vendors. And then the vendors probably hire talented people, including the ethical hackers and researchers and reverse engineers to help.
I would just urge that all of and encourage all of you to connect, start understanding what needs to be done, how it can be done, how you can help support, because security can't be done by just one or two people or organizations or agencies. It's a requirement from all of us to sit down together and do it. And that's exactly what I was trying to say in the morning. If all of us can work together as a group, as a community, we've got a lot of power. If we don't, as individuals, you'll have some power, but as a group, we will not have that power. Let's try and do that.
I'll add something. I'm ready to open a law enforcement chapter of NULL.
Okay, that's a very interesting. Yeah. We should, so that will definitely Bombay, take it up.
I'm in Mumbai, I'm ready to open a chapter for NULL. In fact, you'll be amazed. We have one of the best offices in Mumbai. We are at the 32nd floor of the World Trade Center in Cuff Parade. Once I have given my office to NULL to hold their Saturday sessions.
That's great.
I had given whole of my office to them, you know. And they held it there. So we work closely with the community. And I've been talking to some of your friends. And we'll be very happy to open a law enforcement chapter for this thing.
Great.
And it's up to you now. You can come and participate.
Definitely, we'll take it forward. Okay. So last two more questions quickly.
Sir, what about, my question is to Bijay sir and Sanjay sir.
यार तू तो बॉम्बे वाला है, घर आके पूछ लेना.
So I wanna the public bug bounty program and the private bug bounty program. Can we do something which can encourage all the security researchers? You all know the strengths. Vijay sir was mentioning the power of the community. इनको कोई भी वेबसाइट दे दो, ये उसका, you know what I mean. So why can't there be something? You guys are decision makers.
No, no. As I mentioned to you over lunch, I am looking forward to a detailed document and proposal from your side, and then we'll take it forward. Probably in the next meeting, we'll be able to say something.
Sure. Thank you so much. Yes, and last question.
No, yeah. Yes, he is talking of VAPT, right? Let us say a large infra is hosted. आप VAPT के चक्कर में उसको गिरा दोगे. कौन जिम्मेदारी लेगा? Suppose you are doing VAPT on the railway reservation, and you bring it down. आप बंदर के हाथ में बंदूक नहीं दे सकते ना.
Thank you, sir, for to the entire panel. Lovely, lovely talk. I have two questions. Actually, I've written some articles on this. That's why I thought. One is, when we look at 2019 and beyond, what is the actual risk for India for hacking the election? And I'm not talking about fake news and propaganda with, you know, Twitter trolls from foreign countries. I'm actually talking about actually compromising the facility of the Election Commission, of the war room of political parties. We obviously, our EVMs are off the grid, so that's a good thing, but there are other things which can be compromised. You know, what are the views on that? And then second is, from a geopolitical angle, what is India's risk and preparedness for a onslaught of, you know, a cold war, effectively? Thank
Director,
you.
The Director General CERT, India is the protector of the cyberspace, you know.
There are multiple agencies for your second part. There are multiple agencies who look at that. So I think I will not want to delve into their space, and they are doing whatever is necessary. And the little bit that I am aware of, because that's not my charter, is that a lot from that perspective is being done. The first one, I think I will direct it to him, because that's what he is trying to do. But on that, I will just say that to have that conversation without the Election Commission being here, I think it's not fair, because they have, what I am aware of is they've done a lot of things. We also looked at some of the aspects from an audit perspective, some gaps, etc., which were there. We advised what they should be doing. But obviously, going forward, it's a very different thing. This is what in the past, what I'm trying to tell you.
So if you look at the known vectors, right? So I think the greatest risk is from influence operations. You can do cybersecurity for EVMs and all are pretty secure. Greatest risk would be data breaches and for political parties.
Yes.
That would be the greatest risk. I don't know how much suave they are regarding cybersecurity. So that is a known vector. Secondly, influence operations would be very difficult to control in India, because here everything is amplified in an echo chamber, and sorry, I'm being candid. I'm a police wala, yaar. I know no other way.
And the second largest Facebook users are here, right?
Yeah. So the kind of data that is available outside, you can actually fine grain. See, when you even purchase a Facebook ad, they exactly know your economic status, whether you're married or your relationship is in trouble. Whether your views are right wing or left wing and everything, right? And similarly, if somebody really wants to influence elections with this data, it's not very difficult. Look at what Cambridge Analytica did with this thing. And one of the political parties has brought Cambridge Analytica to India. Best of luck.
Cambridge Analytica has an open presentation on what they've done. So they're not even hiding
Okay, so our time is over. Thank you so much for all the questions, and I would like to thank Dr. Sanjay sir, Mr. Brijesh, and Mr. Vladimir for joining us. So the summary is like, what we need is not a reactive forensic now, it's more of a proactive forensics is what is the need of the hour. So with that, I would like to thank all of you for your complete participation. Thank you so much.